Well, folks, this is what you were begging for and asking for in the Periscope. Thanks for so many people tuning in. That was real nice of you. Many of you were asking for a bracket breakdown, so that's what I'm going to give you here. Also, many of you requested information about my body. Well, I will let you know that it is a temple, and I take care of it in such a way. So I'll be putting out videos here and there with some more Periscopes about my physical regimen and the way that you get to look the way that I look. I will give you a little teaser now. It involves a lot of testosterone, Fireball, whiskey, and laps. But anyways, on to the matter at hand. Breaking down the ESPN Tournament Challenge. This is not a paid ad. I do not work for ESPN. So please know, I'm only using this service because it is available and free, not because I am an employee of ESPN. Anyways, we'll start breaking down a couple of games. I'm not going to go through every single game in a large, you know, really breaking everything down because... Well, honestly, if you need me to tell you that Virginia Tech is going to beat St. Louis for a myriad of reasons, you probably shouldn't be around sharp objects like pencils and pens, so brackets may not really be your thing. But we'll start off at the top of the East, Duke, playing whoever it is they'll end up playing. It's a play-in team, and again, if you need me to tell you that Duke is going to beat them because of, you know, 19 different reasons why Duke's got all this talent and all that stuff, you should probably switch over to the Sesame Street podcast because this is not really going to be your speed. So Duke wins that game. I'm not really sure they'll even play. They'll just probably move them on. The next game's really interesting because you got VCU versus UCF, and UCF is tricky because, you know, they may not play in the championship, but they'll just claim it anyways. Like, that mental gamemanship that they kind of operate in, they just kind of take things that they want regardless of what happens and the outcomes. So a VCU and UCF is really an interesting matchup because VCU could win this game. It's an 8-9, but I think UCF is going to come in. They'll have already won the mental aspect by just telling VCU, hey, you can't beat us. We've already won. And that'll probably mess with VCU's head. They'll be like, what is happening? Is this some kind of time travel kind of situation? Do they already know that they're going to be the Cinderella story? And the next thing you know, UCF has already run off and they've won the game, you know, so that moves them on. Then we got Mississippi State and Lib. I don't like that at all. Mississippi State versus Lib. I do not like that. I do not like ideologue whatsoever. Also, it makes me think of libraries, and I am a large proponent against libraries, so they clearly are not going to go very far, and the SEC grind is going to lead on. So congratulations, Mississippi State. You're moving forward. Then we got Maryland versus Belmont or Temple. Again, playing seeds, they just don't really get to go too far, so I think Maryland's going to be able to handle that. They've got the right talent, got the right skill level. 22-10 team playing in a pretty good league. They started off the season really strong. They had a couple of faults here and there, but again, they're playing seeds, and I don't really see the Temple or Belmont really being able to get past it. I mean, maybe Belmont's got a good team. They've got a lot of skill, so they could be that 11 seed that gets a win, but I just don't see it, and I think Maryland moves forward there. And then LSU and Yale really offers a really interesting situation because LSU has a lot of skill and a lot of talent. I mean, between Naz Reid and Tremont Waters and Javonte Smart, that's a really, really talented team. But they don't have a head coach with Will Wade being suspended due to this whole, you know, paying Javonte Smart and probably the rest of those players to be on the team. And that whole situation can really cause some issues. Because on the other side of this, Yale, you know, their entire team probably paid millions of dollars of their parents' money to be able to get them into college at all. So, you know, I'm officially naming this game the pay-to-playoff game. So that's really an interesting situation between those two. But again, Naz Reid, Tremont Waters, Quindary Weatherspoon, that's a much more skilled basketball team. They have wins over Kentucky and Tennessee. Again, that was with Will Wade on the sideline and without him being there. LSU could really bust a lot of brackets because we really believe in them as SEC teams, as SEC grind. But the next thing you know, they could really disappoint a lot of us just because no head coach, and that could really mess with them mentally. But I got them beating Yale. Again, I think being paid to play probably means you're a better player than those who have paid to play. So I'm going to move LSU on against Maryland for that round of 32. Then Minnesota. Now we get to one of the most interesting games in the whole round of 64, which is the Minnesota-Louisville game in this 10-7 matchup. because here's the situation. Rick Pitino's son now coaches the Minnesota Golden Gophers. And them versus Rick Pitino's old team in Louisville. I mean, I gotta be honest with you. If my son Tanner ever had to coach for my honor against a team that fired me, he better be prepared to go out and whip some ass. I mean, he better be ready to go out there and just beat some people's heads in. Because, I mean, Rick Pitino is basically the grandfather to the Minnesota basketball team. And listen, if you don't want to go out and downfield block your hiney off for your grandpappy, well, sports are probably not really for you, and you need to try something else in your life. So, to me, I just think Minnesota has this whole revenge factor that really fuels them, fires them up, you know. They've got a good non-conference record, but their Big Ten time, it was a struggle. They've got a senior forward in Jordan Murphy, junior guard Amir Coffrey. They've just got a lot of talent, and I think that's going to rise up on top of the fact that, obviously, Rick Pitino, I don't know what he's really doing. I heard he's coaching in, like, Greece or something, but he's clearly Skyping in probably and helping coach this team, and that, to me, really puts them over the top, and so I'm going Minnesota because that's just a lot of talent right there. And then Michigan State versus Brad. Listen, I don't know who this Brad is, but if it's like any other Brad that I know, it probably will end up drunk at a gas station at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So I'm going with Michigan State clearly over that. They're the number two seed. They've got a lot of talent. Tom Izzo as a coach. To me, you know, they're just really better than that. Especially once they got Joshua Langford back into things. So I really believe, I think they're just going to be able to roll through. You know, they got Cassius Winston. And again, Tom Izzo as a head coach is just that. That's what he does. He gets the team firing on all cylinders and they can really, really roll through whoever Brad is. So that's my first, that's the East, breaking that down for the round of 64. Next, we'll move on to the West. Gonzaga against, again, a play-in round situation. Gonzaga is clearly the stronger team. Move them on. Roy Hachimura, he's a great player. They got a lot of talent there. Gonzaga's really, to me, just the, you know, they beat Duke. They only lost to Tennessee by three. They did lose to North Carolina, but, you know, they're a great team. There's a reason they're a number one seed playing in such a tiny little conference. They're just a really, really talented team, and people just believe in them. And so I'm drinking that Kool-Aid a little bit. I tend to avoid Kool-Aid and stick with Fireball, but I'll drink the Kool-Aid on Gonzaga and move them forward. Syracuse and Baylor. Here's the situation. Jim Boeheim has been a mess all year, and I know he's one of the most legendary coaches. He's really had a great run. He's really built some great teams. But here's the deal. He killed a guy this year on accident, which is the weakest way to kill somebody. And he peed himself at one point during a game. And listen, Drake has peed himself many different times during games, but there's a difference between peeing yourself because you're drunk and peeing on yourself because you're too old and you can't control your bladder anymore. And again, all respect to Jim Boeheim because he really has been a great, great coach. But when you start peeing on yourself, you probably shouldn't be leading men on football fields and basketball courts. So to me, I think this is probably it for Jim Boeheim. Baylor knocks Syracuse off, and Jim Boeheim finally knocks off to the land of retirement. The next game, you know, Marquette versus Ja Morant. I got to be honest with you. Ja Morant is a dynamic guard who is probably a top three pick in the NBA draft. You know, we all know Zion's probably going to be number one, but it's kind of him versus RJ Barrett about who really wants to be the next pick, and it's going to be a lot of, you know, what teams really want and what they're looking for. So to me, you know, you kind of got to run with that guard situation. And to me, I think Murray State's a very strong team. I think Ja Morant moves them forward. Next game, Florida State versus Vermont. This is my first real crazy upset, I guess, is Vermont versus Florida State. Listen, Florida State had a great year this year. They've beaten a couple really good teams. You know, they got Virginia at one point, but they also lost to Duke twice, and they lost to North Carolina. They did beat LSU and Purdue. They got Virginia Tech twice, you know. Vermont, on the other hand, has losses to Kansas, Louisville, and Lipscomb. You know, it's not that impressive of a season for Vermont, but they're an impressive team if you really go and see what they do. You know, they're scoring pretty much on average with Florida State. They're right there in that kind of gap, and they hold their opponents to less points. So to me, that kind of puts them over the top, and I took Vermont. You know, it was a gut feeling, and honestly, my gut was a little drunk at that point, but I'm going to take Vermont over Florida State. That's just who I'm taking at this point. Then I got Buffalo beating another play-in team. Texas Tech, they're going to roll on. Red Raiders, they got a great team. They're moving forward. Michigan, I'm going to have them beat whoever it is, Montana or whatever that they're playing. And then Nevada and Florida, that's another interesting situation because Florida, they've had a really good year this year. You know, knocked off LSU twice. They're a tricky team. They could be a lot of people's bracket busters. And a lot of people are going to point to Nevada being a not of having as good a season as they really should have at 29-4. And a lot of people really thought, you know, this is a team that should look to be undefeated. They don't have a crazy difficult schedule. But here's the deal. I've been involved in the Nevada program this year. They had me come in and do a couple lecture series. They had me come in and do some time with the team. They had me help with some recruiting. Listen, Nevada, they have been focused this whole year on the tournament. And honestly, I can't blame them. They live in Reno, Nevada. That's the second biggest city in Nevada. And honestly, you can touch the strippers there. And there's a lot of fun to have in Nevada. You know, you got fireworks, you've got gambling, and you've got Area 51 and the aliens. So I would never bet against anybody from Nevada because aliens are probably involved. And, you know, I just generally do not bet against Area 51. So while Florida could upset Nevada, they got the Morton twins, and twins are obviously aliens, you know. So to me, aliens probably going to put you over whatever else you can do. So to me, I think Nevada moves on here. You know, clearly I know that, and y'all know I put them in my Final Four and in my finals. I truly believe in this program. So this is what they've been focused on all year. They win this game, move on to face Michigan in the round of 32. So that's the West. Next, we'll move on. We'll do the South on the other side. 1 seed Virginia versus 16 seed. Listen, we know what happened last year. Is the first one to ever lose to a 16. And I got to be honest with you, I bet that coal of shame is buried deep in the heart of their program, and it is burning with righteous fury. I myself have never been embarrassed, but I've embarrassed an awful lot of people, and I've got to be honest with you, it is a little bit harder to embarrass them the second time around. So to me, I got to say UVA is probably better than Webb, just, you know, in the metric units of their measurements. And they're going to want this game. They're going to want it real bad. So to me, I say, you know, UVA going to knock Webb off probably pretty easily. Next, we got Oklahoma versus Ole Miss. Listen, we all know what happens when an SEC school plays a Big 12 school. And while Ole Miss, you know, is still a Mississippi school, they are an SEC school. And they've got some good performances this year, even in losses. Next, Oregon, Wisconsin. Listen, Wisconsin's been on a real slide lately. They have lost a lot of their last couple of games. They started off really strong, but have really faded down the stretch. And to me, that just continues into the tournament, and Oregon takes that over. Kansas State over UCI, doesn't matter. Kansas State's going to win. Even though, listen, Bill Snyder is the most overrated coach to ever coach any sport whatsoever. Basketball, football, baseball, any sport that has ever been, water polo. Bill Snyder, most overrated coach ever. He's had like one 10-win season and has a stadium named after him. I may be taking this a little personal because I've been trying since my first championship to get the rec league to name the stadium after me. I mean, it'd be awesome. The Letterman Stadium. And they just haven't done it. And I didn't know all I had to do was win 10 games. I just won some championships upon championship. I mean, I've got rings on rings on rings on rings, and Bill Snyder's sitting there going like, I won 10 games once. That's the dumbest thing in the world that he should be allowed to have a stadium named after him. Regardless, I have Kansas State moving on past UCI because, well, I don't really believe in whoever UCI is. Then we got Villanova versus SMC. Listen, St. Mary's has got a lot of things going their way, but Villanova is the defending national champions, and even though this year has been a little rougher on them, they still have Jay Wright as a coach, and as a coach, I got to go with one of the best coaches in the country. You know, they still score pretty effectively, even though they've really had to mix up a lot of the people who they had returning from last year's team. And in kind of moving that around, it really started their season off a little bit harder. They're still a good team. They're still efficient. They're still strong. And to me, again, I just say Jay Wright is the better coach. He's a great coach, and he can really lead this team on. So I take Villanova over St. Mary's there. Purdue, they've got a great team. You know, they're very physical. They've got wins over Michigan State, over Wisconsin. And I know Drew Brees does not play quarterback for their basketball team, but I just say, you know, they can probably move on. They've got a pretty good conference record. Carson Edwards is a good player, 23 points a game. That's a high score. And so that's kind of what I got there. Boilermakers gonna roll on over the Monarchs. Cincinnati and Iowa offers us an interesting situation because Iowa is a very strong, talented team. They've got a lot of skill, but they ended the season on a skid.
you know, and then fell really hard to Michigan in the quarterfinals of the Big Ten tournament. Where the Bearcats, on the other hand, in Cincinnati, a couple years ago, there's a video come out of them getting into this, like, giant brawl after a game. And I got to be honest with you, ever since then, I've been using that video in my fall camp just to show the real aggressive nature that we want to try to emulate on the field. So just out of pure gumption, I think Cincinnati wins that game pretty handedly. And then Tennessee versus Colgate. Listen, if an SEC school can't go out and beat a toothpaste company at some basketball, I don't really know what else you're looking for. Colgate is just about as wide as the toothpaste they're supposed to be. And Tennessee has Admiral Schofield, who is a monster. I don't know what that guy is on, but I need to get some of it and inject it into some of my football players. And Grant Williams has the dumpster of a god. I mean, his butt, I don't normally talk about another man's derriere, but man, the way he sweeps that big thing and just moves people out of the way is a work of art. I mean, it's quite impressive. So I think they ride that derriere, you know, straight on to the Final Four, and so they're going to clearly roll over Colgate. So that's kind of my thoughts on the South. You know, it's a little more chalk there, but I got a couple of things here and there where I think, 12 beating a 5, some things like that. But I think it's a pretty clear bracket on that side. Finally, I'm going to move on to the Midwest. You know, just roll through this real quick. I'm going to move through it pretty quickly just because, well, honestly, I think it's pretty clear why I made most of these decisions. And also, I am running late to get down to the Beef O'Brady's. I got to make a couple deals this year with some other coaches because honestly, I don't have the first pick this year in the draft, and I'm pretty sure whoever has it is going to be taking Jordo. So I discovered that kid, and I am not going to play against him. So we're going to rectify this situation real quick. So got to go make some deals. Also, if y'all can just give me a second, I just got to let y'all know there's some stuff going on in our league that's really pissing me off. Number one, they're making me hire a trainer. So I have to bring a new person onto the staff. And the guy I've hired seems pretty cool, but hopefully we'll be able to find a way to use him that'll actually be effective. Because here's the other thing they've done. They have outlawed the three-point stance. What are we doing to football now? So we're not going to have a three-point stance, and we're going to have trainers. You want me to have a trainer because of injuries, but then you're taking away the three-point stance, which is where most of the injuries occur. So why are we putting a hat on a hat here? Huh? I don't understand why we have bowed down to big pharma and to big parenting and said, you know what? I will let this occur in my league. It frustrates me so much. And I have done petitions. I have protested. I have literally stood outside the rec center office with the picket fence. And I have screamed and shouted and barked at people in the face. And there's nothing I can do. They will not cave to my pressures. But I will tell you this, they will rue the day that they decided. They will rue it because I have drawn up a whole lot of plays from the four-point stance. We are just going to bull rush all game long. I mean, people, we are going to make the entire league regret the day they said, nope, no three-point stance. Because I'll tell you what, we are going to wreck some people's lives this year in the four-point stance. And I'll tell you this right now, when you see Jordo down in the four-point stance getting ready to come running at your quarterback, you're going to go, maybe made a bad plan to get rid of the three-point stance. So just saying, we're going to be changing a couple things there. But anyways, back to the matter at hand with the bracket. North Carolina, going to roll over Iona. Listen, Coby White is a fantastic basketball player. He's got fantastic care, and Roy Williams is a great coach. So move them right on. Then Washington and USU. Listen, Washington is, you know, they're a good team. They play in a good conference. I know they don't score quite as much as USU does, but to me, I think they're a better team. And I'm gonna roll Washington right there. I'm gonna roll them on. And then Auburn versus New Mexico State. Listen, Auburn has peaked at the exact right time. They've taken it to Tennessee, I've got high thoughts on Tennessee, so Auburn really plays well, and Bruce Pearl, you know, he's a good coach, screams and sweats a lot, so I respect that, and Brown and Harper are a great duo of guards. They did lose Kentucky twice this year, they lost to Duke, lost to LSU, but to me, that team really, you know, they've been hot and cold for most of the year, and now is really getting hot. And they just, I mean, the way they shoot threes and the speed they run is just going to really run through a couple of teams. And I think one of those teams will be New Mexico State. So Auburn moves on there. Kansas, I can't believe they're not going to win a game here in the tournament. I know they've fallen on some hard times and had a lot of issues. Adoka Azubuike and a couple of their other players have been hurt. And, you know, they're having some struggle because of that. But they're still a good team, and they've still got great coaching. And I think, to me, at some point, that's going to kick in, and they'll be able to beat the Huskies and move on forward there. Iowa State versus Ohio State. Iowa State's had a great year. They've really, you know, they're a good team, and I just believe that that's a really great team right there. They score. They're a great scoring team. You know, they kind of got back on track in the Big 12 Conference Tournament, and their offense is really efficient. So, to me, I moved them on over Ohio State, who I think Ohio State's just always overrated, honestly. They get a lot of favor in football, and they probably got it here in basketball, too. So, I'm moving Iowa State on real, real fine. Houston, they roll through, no problems there. Wofford and Seton Hall is really interesting. I think Wofford has had a really great season, 29-4. Listen, they hold their opponents to less points and score a lot more points than Seton Hall does. So to me, Wofford is a pretty much no-brainer situation. I mean, their losses are all to really great teams, and so I just move Wofford on. They've had a great season, and you know, so congratulations, you're moving on to the round of 32. And then University of Kentucky, they're going to roll through this. John Calipari has sold his soul to be able to get players. You know, P.J. Washington, Tyler Hero, however you pronounce it. Honestly, Kentucky's just too much for them to handle. They're going to move on. So that's my thought to the first round of the brackets. You know, after that, everything's going to kind of get into a little bit of madness. I might do a Periscope sometime next week before the next couple of games when we get through the round of 32. There's some interesting matchups in that. But we'll see you in the challenge.